this is our Airbnb or whatever. Okay, what's in here? I think it's the washer and dryer. It got a washer and dryer. Okay. I think the aesthetics. And then it's got a balcony. This is a big balcony. What are we overlooking? Look at it's got a nice playground underneath there. And this balcony is huge. So it goes all the way to the bedroom. It's got a little table out here. And I don't know where we're at, but I know we're right downtown. And it's got a little across the street. It's got a kids playground. That's cool if you got kids. We gotta go check the pool. This is the bedroom. And then you can get to the balcony from here too. Or maybe not. Oh yeah, you can. So you can get to the balcony from here or from there. This is real nice or whatever. It feels good inside here. So this is nice. And then there's a closet right there. And why is the thing flickering? And there's a walk-in closet. And then this is the bathroom. Why is the thing flickering? That's so weird. This is the bathroom. And that's the shower. So that's the Airbnb. That's the Airbnb. Okay, so what we about to do? What we about to do? I gotta use the bathroom. I'm about to.
So it's the day after. It's the day after. Next morning, where's my coffee? And I just got up. What time is it? I got up at like 5 in the morning. And you guys, I freaking fell asleep with my teeth whitener on. Because I brought my teeth whitener strips. Cause I've been whitening my teeth with these professional 20 pack Crest 3D whitening strips, the professional ones or whatever. And I'm gonna be doing a video on that to show you guys how that works. But I freaking fell asleep 15 minutes and you leave them on for 45 minutes and I left. And you have them on for 45 minutes, and I freaking had 15 minutes to go, and I fell asleep, and I woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning and realized I had them on still. So I'm just having some coffee. It's a beautiful day out. Hold on. Let me see. It is a beautiful day out. The sun is out and it is, the heat is blasting, you guys. It's like freaking, feels like it's 100 degrees out here. It feels like it's 100 degrees out here. I have pre-op. Here, kitty, kitty, kitty. So I have pre-op. So here is my intake on pre-op. I don't get to see my doctor pre-op because he's on vacation until tomorrow. He's on vacation from the 2nd until the 10th. So I don't get to see him or meet him until tomorrow. I'm hoping that I get to record in my pre-op. I hope I get to record tomorrow. I hope he'll let me record tomorrow, but he seems pretty friendly. Like, just the couple of the little research that I've done. But anyhow, I just talked to Miriam, my surgery coordinator, and I asked her, what time should I go? What time is it? So it's 10:21. It's 10:21, and I asked my surgery coordinator. She was like, I just was about to call you. So I asked her, what time should I come up there? Oh, I'm 10 minutes away, by the way, you guys. I'm like two blocks up the road from Silhouette, my plastic surgery center. So if you guys don't know, I am having plastic surgery. I'm having supposedly a BBL. Hopefully, I've been eating. I ate so much, you guys. I literally did not eat when I was at the airport. I grabbed soup, sandwich, salad, fruit cup, a muffin. I grabbed some of everything. I've been trying to eat so much. If I don't have enough, I'm supposed to get a BBL with leg lipo. If I don't have my surgery coordinator, not Miriam, but the other one, Tatiana, she couldn't tell by my pictures if I have enough of fat in the pictures that I sent to her last week with me standing, with me sitting, with me grabbing the little fat that I have when I took a picture like this. She couldn't tell me if I have enough of fat or not for a BBL. So I have to wait until I talk to Dr. Michael Rodriguez. So my anxiety, I didn't take my anxiety medication. So that's why I'm like real fidgety, because I'm talking and my anxiety is up a little bit. I don't know why. And it's freaking hot in here, baby. They should turn the heat off. Yeah, 79 degrees. I'm gonna put it to 72. Cause it's hot as hell outside. So anyhow, Tatiana says she can't tell if I have enough of fat to have a BBL or not. So I have to wait until tomorrow, day of surgery. I have tomorrow surgery. I'll find out today. So today I have pre-op, and I just got off the phone with Miriam, and Miriam was like, I was just about to call you. And I was like, what time should I come for pre-op so that I'm not waiting all day? Because pre-op is only consisting of signing the paperwork. That's it. That's all pre-op is signing your life away. That can happen to you. But that's all pre-op is signing paperwork. So she's like, well, so she put me on hold. And so then my next question was, it does take a while. And I'm like, well, it's just filling out the paperwork. So she put me on hold, and then she comes back and she's like, well, it does take a couple hours. So I'm like, what time do you close? So she's like, 4:00. I'm like, okay, bet. I'm coming there before 4:00, period. I'm coming there before 4:00, because what I'm not about to do is waste my last day. Because we got here not till 5:30. By the time we got to the room and got settled, it was 6:30. What I'm not about to do is waste my whole day waiting up there. Because I heard that people have been waiting all day long at Silhouette on pre-op. I'm not about to do that. I'm about to make it like it's the welfare building or something. And I'm going to go there right before the end of closing. That's how I'll do. I'm going to get there right before closing. Right before 4:00, I'm gonna leave here probably 3:30, literally. So I'm gonna go and enjoy the day. We're gonna go over there. I'm probably gonna put my bathing suit on and go right over to the pool. And then head over there to the surgery center for pre-op. And probably leave at 3:30. Because they close at 4:00. They close at 4. For pre-op, they close at 4. So I'm going to leave here at 3:30 and get there at 4:00. That's what I'm going to do. So that's what I have going on today is pre-op. So if everybody has that same agenda though, that would be kind of crazy if everybody does the same thing. Waits until the last minute, because you know you gotta be seen. So if everybody waited till the last minute to go right before closing, because they don't close at 4, they close at 5. So leaving, I'm literally 10 minutes away. I'm 2 blocks up the road. So on the GPS, I'm here on GPS. Like literally, let me show you. I can show y'all exactly how close I am. This is how close I am to the surgery center. This is how close I am. So I'm here at this green dot, and the surgery center is right there. So literally, I am. It says 12 minutes, but I'm 6.3 miles away. So I'm up. I'm like down the road. So this mile is pretty, because I mean, if you think about it, a mile, but I'm just a straight shot though. So anyhow, that's what I got going on for today. And I'm about to finish my little coffee. And I'm about to put on my bathing suit and go to the pool. And yeah. So I want to meet you guys probably like, well, I'll probably come back on when we're at the pool. I'm probably gonna touch up my little edges and stuff though, after I do my little hygiene. I do my little morning hygiene. You guys, my corner edge eyelashes came off loose yesterday, and I brought some eyelashes and some glue and tweezers with me. But I'm not gonna redo my eyelashes because I don't know if the silhouette is gonna take out my eyelashes during surgery. Because Ivana, when I had surgery 2 years ago in 2019, I had just did my eyelashes, and when I woke up, my eyelashes were completely gone. So I'm not gonna waste my pack of eyelashes. I'm gonna have surgery tomorrow anyways. So it's only a little bit right here. This, like, I can notice it because the fullness is not there on the edge. Yvette says you can't notice it, but I can notice it. And my little bronzing tan is gone. I'm missing my little bronzing tan. I mean, y'all can see it, but y'all might not be able to notice it, but I can notice it. All right, I'll see you guys when I am at the pool. So we are about to get ready to go to the pool.
People here, and we are scheduled here to go for surgery, and she said take a seat. There's no freaking seat. This is what is full.
Oh,
She said, take a seat. And she said, take a seat. You scheduled me for. And you come in for your surgery. And this is all these people when you come in for your surgery. And I gotta say, when I went in for surgery at Ivana, that I didn't go through any of this. I did not have to stand and wait for my surgery. I'm standing, literally. I'm standing, waiting for my surgery. Who, me? Because I slept right here, but I don't have nothing right here. And why? So I want some taken off right here and the inside of my legs. And my boobs. So anyways, this is where I'm at right now. So I'm here waiting with all these. I'm here waiting with all these freaking people, and I don't even get a seat. And I'm here for my 1 o'clock to get surgery, you guys. So stay tuned. I'm meeting with Dr. Mike. It is 1:08. It's 1:08. And my appointment to have surgery is at 1 o'clock. So stay tuned, and I'll be meeting with Dr. Mike and see how this goes. So I have to do the drug test.
Okay.
Okay.
Compression socks. Okay.
The fancy Jordans.
Okay. For head.
Okay. Okay.
Oh my God, it's real.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, what?
I
give it to you.
Okay.
Give me a minute.
Okay.
I have a
this is
in case for boobs.
Ah, okay.
This.
Foam.
Foam.
Okay.
It's extra large. Okay. It's the one that extra I got from Havana. Yeah.
Okay.
An extra.
Okay.
Extra.
Okay.
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 I already lost a couple pounds.
Yes.
Because you guys could not eat.
Yeah.
I was 160. I was 172 yesterday, and I'm 167, 66.
Okay.
Okay. I got a headache, so. I know, I freaking got nervous and I went to the bathroom without doing the cup or whatever.
Okay.
I got nervous.
Well, Virginia, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
Okay. Have a seat.
Can I get a hug?
Sure.
Okay.
How you doing? Have a seat.
Okay. So I've been trying to find out for a long time if I can have BBL or what, because I gained weight 20 pounds, but then Tatiana from the picture, she's like, oh, I don't know, you gotta talk to the doctor.
What's your priority?
I wanna do a BBL, but I have my, where did she put my wish pick, my pictures?
So your priority is
it's
your
a BBL.
Butt. No, forget the procedure. What body part is the most important perceived body part for
my
you?
My butt.
So then it's a BBL.
I want some projection.
Okay.
Because I had one in 2019, and what happened was, they put more fat in my hips, and I'm already wide set. I already have natural hips wide.
Also,
hips
but that's anyways. All. Let me tell you, that's the place that does better with fat transfers. In other words, fat transfers don't do as well for projection as they do for hips. They do much better in hips than they do for projection.
So I always had wide hips. So they put hips to, I guess, try to fill in a hip dip.
Okay.
But they put all the fat in there, so they put barely nothing back there.
Okay.
So then I ended up going.
So you want to focus on putting for projection.
Projection, exactly. Okay. I was supposed to come here to see you December 8th last year.
Okay.
Tried to lose 15, 20 pounds, and I lost 40 pounds.
Good for you.
Got down to 148, and it took me a whole year to gain this, but I don't know if I have enough of fat.
Okay, we'll take a look at you. We are 40 years old?
Yes.
How is your health?
Great.
You take any pills for any reason?
I do. Antidepressant and anxiety.
What's the antidepressant?
Wellbutrin.
Wellbutrin?
Yep. And then Topamax for anxiety.
Topamax, all right.
Yep.
Previous surgical procedures. You said you had a BBL in 2019?
Yep, I did.
And you went to sleep and you woke up, right?
Yeah.
Any other abdominal procedures?
No.
Gallbladder, appendix, C-section, tubal.
Nope.
And you smoke?
Never.
Any allergies to medications?
No.
All right. And I see you signed up for a couple extra areas of liposuction.
Yes, in my legs. I have some problem air. Well, okay. My inside, and then I want to show you. I don't know where the heck is my book. And then what the heck? And I always have. I'm going to show you. I always had this fat area right here.
Okay.
That never let me get like a definition from here to right. My butt.
It's so not just fat though, it's a skin problem too. In other words, you see how it's kind of loose and sagging? So you know, not everything is, you know, with volume. Some of it is required lifting and things like that. But go ahead, take your gown off.
Yeah, so like if you take
over there, we'll take some photos.
If you take the
I need some lip gloss because I don't need my lips to be dry, and I think I need some water for this, you guys. I might need some wine. I may just need a little bit of wine for this because, whew, y'all, I needed to so that I didn't ramble on. I needed to bullet in order how I wanted to, I needed to bullet how I wanted to let you guys know, or how I wanted to organize. I wanted to make sure, I wanted to put this vlog as organized as possible because I tend to go out on tangents and ramble. This is the only gloss I could find. And I can't find nothing else, so. But anyhow, so I had to bullet, so I do have my little notebook so that I can try to stay on, like, in order. But what's up, everybody? My name's Jennifer Marie, the Money Saver, and I'm doing my vlog finally on my surgery that I had at Silhouette Plastic Surgery with Dr. Magic Mike. And I am 1 month post-op, well, coming up 1 month post-op on the 12th. Would have been the 11th, but I'm gonna get into that. So stay tuned on that. Okay, so I'm going to give you a little backstory on. So I originally was booked on. I originally paid my deposit back in April, specifically April 11th on 2020. I'm going to insert my receipt right here to show when I booked and what I booked for, which is my BBL. And I was originally scheduled for surgery on December 8th of 2020. So my surgery coordinators changed like 3 times, and for those that don't know, I ended up trying to lose some weight the end of August of last year, 2020. I tried to lose like 15, 20 pounds. and I lost 40 pounds. So as it got closer to the time that I needed to have my lab work done, I believe it was November 13th last year, I had lost almost close to like 30 pounds at that time. So I frantic, I panicked, you know my anxiety. I don't know if you guys know. If you guys don't know, I have really bad anxiety. I take medication for it, whatever, whatever. And so I frantic, I panicked, whatever. And I contacted Selena. If you guys don't know, Selena is the manager at Silhouette. So I called and got in contact with Selena, and she saw my pictures and she was like, honey, you'd have no fat. And she was telling me I only have X amount of cc's worth of fat. And I was like, well, what does that mean? And she says, well, to put it in terms that you understand, you have about a half a Coca-Cola worth of fat. So she told me I need to drink Ensure, I need to eat carbohydrates, pasta, whatever. So I tried to gain weight like within them 3 weeks and it just was not happening. I was losing more weight. So I ended up rescheduling because Selena told me I could reschedule. So I ended up rescheduling and I rescheduled for August 11th, 2021. So that was giving me from December until August. That was giving me some time to gain some weight. So moving forward, you know, I just want to give you guys like a little background story on how everything like started, when I first originally booked and what I booked for and all of that good stuff. So I rescheduled and I was pushing to gain weight. However, I was not gaining weight. I was losing more weight. I ended up losing 40 pounds. I ended up going from 186 down to a grand total of 148. So by the time I got to, I had gained like 10 pounds only by the time I got to the end of April. So end of April, I had only 3 months. From April 27th, I only had gained like 10 pounds. And I was still super, super skinny. So I was like, this isn't going to work. I have no fat anywhere. So I just started eating blizzards every day. And for 3 months, I ate blizzards every day. If it wasn't a blizzard every day, I was eating Mexican ice creams. I was going to the store, getting Mexican peanuts, vanilla ice cream, chocolate sauce, whipped cream, bananas. I was making Mexican sundaes. I was eating ice cream every day. Or I was going to the Abbott's custard. Frozen custard ice cream place, getting a large cone with sprinkles. I was eating ice cream every single day for 3 months. Boom, I ended up gaining 21 pounds. So when I did my labs, I was 164. And then when I got to Silhouette for my pre-op on the 10th of August, I was 171. So I had gained from 148, and then I was 153. I was 153 on March 11th. And so from 153, I got to 164 for my pre-op. I had my pre-op in July something. So whatever. So moving forward, whatever the case may be, moving forward, my surgery date was scheduled for August the 11th. I flew out to Atlanta. I flew out to Miami on the 9th, and I flew out not knowing if I had enough of weight, having enough of fat. But I did have a backup plan in mind. I was going to go with having my boobs, getting a boob lift and a implants in place of the BBL if I didn't have enough of fat, because my surgery coordinator could not tell if I had enough of fat when I sent her pictures the week before. And I sent her pictures with me sitting down, standing up this way, I stood this way, backwards, like from behind. I sat down like this, I hunched over, I grabbed my fat. So I grabbed whatever fat I had. She still couldn't tell me whether or not I had enough fat. So I had to wait until I saw Dr. Mike on my surgery day. He was on vacation from the 2nd until the 10th. So I couldn't see him on my pre-op day. So fast forward to surgery day on the 11th. I met with Dr. Magic Mike, and it didn't go so well. It turned out it was okay at first, and then I instantly got really nervous because I did have videos, I had other clips, I had somebody recording, but I don't know what happened to the files. They got deleted, lost somehow, but nonetheless, whatever the case may be, I don't know what happened to them, but I'm gonna explain to you what happened. I basically was told, I do have a screenshot of when he took a picture of my stomach and was explaining to me that I have deformities on my stomach from my previous BBL that I got on August 28th, 2019, that the doctor went aggressively. You could see the discoloration on my stomach. I have deformities, aka lumps, and that it's gonna mess me up even more on my stomach, and he doesn't wanna touch it. He kept asking, do you want your stomach to be messed up, yes or no? Do you wanna have your stomach worse, yes or no? And I'm like, no. And he's like, okay, moving on. So I'm like, so I'm standing there, butt naked, and I'm like, you know, because he's gotta check you out, and because you're about to go to surgery, so he's got to, like, mark you on where you're going to have surgery. So he basically was like, okay, if you don't want to be messed up, then I'm not going to do the lipo on you. And I'm like, okay. So in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, well, forget about lipo 360. I'll just get the breast lift with the gummy bear implants, and, you know, plan B. I'm thinking, okay, plan B, fine, cool. Let me just get the leg lipo, because I did add on for $2,000 extra. I added on two areas of leg lipo, inside and outside legs. So I'm thinking, okay, fine, I'll just get the breast lift with the gummy bear implants and get the leg lipo. No. So, that didn't work either. He was like, you're gonna have your, mind you, all right, I was just 148 pounds, got to 153 because I purposely, let's keep in the back of our minds, guys, I had to purposely gain weight to have fat to gain, I had to purposely gain weight in order to get the surgery, right? Because I had no fat to pull, right? Because the whole point was to get the BBL. That's what I was going for initially, and I ended up losing weight and I had to gain weight. So I was just skinny as hell, right? I'm gonna insert pictures, okay? I was just skinny as hell. So let me tell you what I was being told. Dr. Magic Mike was like, okay, if I do leg lipo, your legs are going to be saggy, and they're gonna look old, and they're gonna be like a deflated balloon. They're gonna be like when you blow up a balloon and the air deflates, they're gonna be like a deflated balloon. And I'm trying to explain to him, no, they aren't. I just was super skinny. And I have my phone. I'm super nervous because he's telling me these negative things. And I'm like, I was just skinny, just freaking like 3 months ago, 2 months ago, before I gained these 20 pounds on purpose. And my legs, I had a gap in between my legs. He was telling me I was going to have worse cellulite. Maybe I was going to have worse cellulite than what I have now. And all this stuff, okay, that's what he was telling me, that I was going to have saggy legs, they were going to look old and saggy, they were going to look like a deflated balloon. So, I had my phone in my hand, and I'm trying to show him pictures of when I just literally was just skinny, 148 pounds, 153 pounds, and I found some pictures. I should have went on my website, I wasn't even thinking. But I was so nervous that I wasn't clearly thinking. But I came across some pictures when I had some little shorts. I'm going to show you right here the pictures that I came across that I showed him. So he goes, I said, look how skinny I was. My legs were not cellulite. My legs were not saggy when I was just skinny. That's how my legs would be if you pulled the fat out of my legs. And you could do the BBL, or actually, no, if I would have just had leg lipo, then I wouldn't have had the BBL with leg fat. I would have just got the leg lipo and the breast lift with implants, with the gummy bears. But he was like, you got Spanx on. The Spanx are holding your legs in. So I'm like, okay. He's like, do you got any pictures, any photos with swimsuit? So I'm thinking, I got some recent photos that I had just taken, but I didn't have any that I took while I was skinny, while I was super skinny. I had photos with me modeling my mode of fashion, fitness stuff, but I didn't have any showing, I didn't have any photos showing like my legs to show like what my legs looked like bare. So I was trying, and while I was trying, and mind you, I was the last patient. I was the last patient. So when I was told and I was texted that my surgery was at 1 o'clock, I wasn't seen until after 3 o'clock. And so I was his last patient, and it was like as if I was being rushed. And while I was looking for a picture to show him, to prove to him, I basically was trying to prove to him that no, my legs were not going to be saggy and old and this, that, and the other. And he right then and there was like, you know what, it was nice meeting you. This is literally what happened. It was nice meeting you, and I'm sorry, I'm not going to perform your surgery. And he literally walked out just like that. So I took off the hospital, the robe that you put on. I took that off, and I took off the hair cap. I took everything off and got dressed. And I just was like literally in shock. Like, what the freak? What the hell? I'm out here in Miami. I spent all this money on an Airbnb, flights for somebody to come down with me and myself, and then I spent all that money, like we're talking over $6,000 for surgery, and I'm like, what now? That's all I can think of is what now. So he heard me, and he's like, you can go downstairs. Or you can go upstairs and go see about getting your deposit back. So I go upstairs and I'm like flipping out. I'm like bawling at that point. I'm bawling my eyes out and I'm like looking. I'm trying to find pictures, talking to myself, crying, and like bawling my eyes out. And I'm in the, like, because other customers, other girls, ladies, men, whoever's up there, they're hearing me, watching me, and I'm like, what the, I'm just like, going like, I was so confused and like emotional. I was like, what the hell just happened? And my surgery coordinator and my other coordinator comes out and pulls me in the back in the office and was like, what happened? And I'm showing her, I'm showing both of them and telling them that he refused me surgery. He refused me lipo. He refused me lipo, telling me my legs would be, and I'm like crying while I'm showing. I'm like, look at how I just was. Look at how, and I'm showing them the same picture with my shorts on. I'm like, look at how skinny I was. I was just skinny. I gained 20 pounds just to get this surgery. And so basically they really, really helped me. My surgery coordinator was Miriam. And then both of my coordinators pulled me in the office, was like, what happened? I'm crying. While I'm crying, I'm showing them the pictures of what I just look like, literally how skinny I just was before I gained 20 pounds. I'm like, I gained 20 pounds just for the surgery. Told them how Dr. Magic Mike denied me lipo, walked out on me. I'm like, I don't know what to do now and stuff. And so they basically were like, do you want us to see if another surgeon, they were asking me if I wanted another surgeon to evaluate me and see if they will give me an evaluation to perform lipo. And I was not up for that because I'm not up for a surgeon that I have no idea who they are, know nothing about. I was not up for that. So I'm like, no. So then basically the one surgeon, she was so awesome. She really helped me and calmed me down. And I want to know what her name is. I don't know why I can't think of what her name is. But she was like, she basically talked me into, she was like, how about you just get just only your breast done? And then she was like, do you want me to talk to Dr. Mike and see if he'll do just your breasts and, you know, do just your breast lift and your gummies, you know, do just your breast job. And I was like, yes. And, you know, I was like, yeah. So she goes and she comes back and she was like that they're going to be able to squeeze me in tomorrow. So don't ask me how they were able to squeeze a whole extra surgery in unplanned. That's a mystery to me. Where in the heck is my... Don't even get me started. Okay, here we go. Here we go. Invoice. Okay, boom. SilhouetteMiami.com. Okay. I'm about to tell you what her name is. So, Marion. They got the Tatiana. So, Tatiana. She was awesome. Tatiana, if you're watching this, you really helped me out, calmed me down. And I thank you for that because I was like such a freaking hysterical, emotional wreck. Like I had no idea what I was gonna do. Like literally, I don't want to start like bawling out because like I'm like feeling like I was like in that moment. I'm feeling like I was in that moment like right now. Like I couldn't believe all that happened. Like it was so nuts. And like, it just was crazy. It really was freaking crazy how everything happened. I was like, I had no idea what was gonna happen. And I just can't believe that he walked out on me and just was like, I'm not gonna do your surgery because, you know, he felt like because I had deformities. And then, so that's that. So my coordinators, Tatiana and Marion, they set it up and, you know, helped me out, calmed me down. And so, boom, I ended up getting rescheduled for the next day for the breast lift and gummy bears. And I ended up going the next day to have the surgery. I was told at 1 o'clock. And I didn't have the surgery until after 3. They squeezed me in. Dialogue was much better. I was so nervous though. I was really, really nervous before meeting with him because I didn't know what to expect. But when he came in, the dialogue was much better and I was more relaxed and relieved. I do gotta say that. And I just went right into, went right into anesthesia. He marked me up and everything like that. I explained to him what I wanted. I always wanted to have my boobs done for many years. So it's not like it wasn't something that I didn't want done. Because I actually, if I did get the BBL, I was planning on getting my boobs done anyways in November. That's on my wish list. It's in my book. So I was going to get them done anyhow because I've been wanting to get them done for a long time. So I explained to him what I wanted and he heard me out and he was able to, I wanted just only the circle cut around just my nipples. I did not want the line coming underneath. However, he was only able to do that on the right side. He wasn't able to do it on the left side. I'm kind of a little disappointed on that, but it's just because initially prior to my breast lift, the left side was bigger than the right side. So he removed some tissue out of the left side. And so I had to have the line going down from the nipple and the cut. So I have the cut underneath the nipple on there and underneath there, but on the side I didn't have to. So he was able to make my request on the right side, but he was not able to on the left side. But he was able to halfway meet my request. I like that, you know, at least he was able to do it on one side. But I explained to him what I wanted done, and I went under anesthesia right away. I didn't feel any sting. I didn't even know, like, I felt the wooziness and I was out. Literally, I was out so fast. And when I woke up from the surgery, I was able to walk straight to the car. I had no pain right waking up from the surgery and like for a few hours after. But that night, that's a whole different, like later on that day of surgery and thereafter, whole different story, but I'll get to that later. But I was able to walk to the car and walk inside and go up the elevator and go to my Airbnb with no problem. I was alert, fully functionally alert, unlike my experience with when I had a BBL. Totally different experience. And so next day I went, which was Friday the 13th, I went for my post-op checkup and that did not go so well. That's when things took a turn. Things took a definite turn and my steri strips that are placed over the sutures were removed. And I was told that my left nipple could fall off and that I have possible necrosis, and I fainted completely right then and there in the office, cold out, flat out, fainted, and woke up in the hospital bed to a nurse on one side of me giving me coffee and then another nurse on that side. All I remember was a nurse doing like this with rubbing alcohol. I smell alcohol and that's how I woke up. And they were about to give me an IV because they said that my blood pressure completely dropped very low. So I had completely fainted, and yeah, I was told that my left nipple is completely off, and it was. Anyhow, so I downed a whole thing of Libby's pineapple juice, then I got another thing of pineapple juice and downed that. So I downed two things of pineapple juice. I don't know if you guys know, but pineapple juice has some natural elements in it that heals you. And I also, you guys, I wanted a drink so freaking bad. You want to talk about my anxiety was out the roof? My anxiety was out the roof, okay? My anxiety was out the roof, but I was like, I Googled it. What happens if you have a drink and it says it thins out your blood? And if you guys, I'm going to tell you guys all about necrosis, but it's when you don't have enough of blood supply. I needed all the blood supply I can get, so having a drink of alcohol was not going to do it because it was going to thin out your blood. And no, I needed all the blood supply I can get. As a matter of fact, let me take some vitamins so that I can have a good, healthy blood supply. I need the iron. And yes, so I was downing pineapple juice, Gatorade. Like, I wanted my skin to be nourished. I wanted my skin to be healthy. I wanted it to be hydrated, and then the Neosporin had like Bactrim, and then the saline wash. So and then the bruising like around it started yellowing out, and that's what you want. Like if you ever had a dark purple bruise and you see it start getting kind of yellowish, that's what it kind of did. So I started feeling a little bit better. Now I was told, because I texted the doctor some concerns, and then I was doing my research, so I was asking him about some different medications, and then he had prescribed me something, and I ended up getting a prescription from him when I went to go check in on Monday the next day, and it was like a cream. So I asked him about this prescription that I did some research on. He didn't end up giving me that prescription. He ended up giving me some other type of prescription that I did use Monday night, but it's for burns. It's for like second and third degree burns. And I used it that Monday night, and I felt like my nipple start, I don't remember what it was, but it was, I don't even remember what it was. I think I still have it. It came in a little jar with a little twisty. Hold on, let me go get it, and I'm going to tell you what it was. Basically, if you guys have necrosis, or was told that you have possible necrosis, and are given instructions to take care of it, or you're told that you have possible necrosis, then the only thing that you can do is take care of it like it's a wound. You want to get you some saline wash. But anyways, if you are told that you have possible necrosis and it scares the shit out of you like it did me, and I completely cold out fainted when I was told my nipple could fall off, the only thing that you can do is care for the area like it's a wound and get you some saline wash, which is at your local pharmacy. It's at Publix if you're going down south, or you're in the international area. If you're going overseas, Dominican Republic, some people go to the Dominican Republic, or if you're in the Miami or wherever you're going, get some saline wash. Make sure you're washing the area with dial soap. You don't have to wash it with dial soap every time. you do want to change it often. You want to change it 3 to 4 times a day. Get some saline wash. Nine out of ten, it comes in a can that squirts out. It comes out in pressure, so you don't want to pressure because it you have sutures still, so you don't want to open the sutures with the power pressure of the saline wash. So what I did was I squirted the saline wash in a gauze, and then with the saline wash on the gauze, I went around the wounded area with the saline wash on the gauze, and then kind of let that area dry, and then I put the Neosporin on another piece of gauze, and then I applied the gauze with the Neosporin on the area. I never applied the Neosporin on with my finger. I put the Neosporin on a clean piece of gauze and then applied the gauze with the Neosporin. So you want to get some, preferably get the Neosporin with the itch. There's a type of Neosporin that has pain plus itch on it, because as your sutures heal, you will have an itch as it heals. Now, I want to cover the yeast infection. After you heal, if it turns out to not be necrosis, hopefully, prayerfully, it's not necrosis, you want to discontinue the Neosporin. You don't want to apply too much Neosporin. Apparently, I applied too much Neosporin. You only need a thin coat. If you're applying too much Neosporin, you can get yeast infection. So if you have a type of itch that's burning, you're using too much. And if you're having a type of itch that is burning and you have like a raw, patchy type of sensation and look, then contact and reach out to your surgeon to see if you're developing a yeast infection on your nipples. So I'm not going to insert pictures of what that looks like, but it'll be really, really red, and you'll have like patches of like blood, like little patches. But don't use too much Neosporin. You only need a thin bowl. I was only left with the option to, I was just only told to take care of the wound area. I was only told to take care of my nipple with an area that has a possible necrosis, as if it was a wound, and to wash it, to get saline wash and take care of it like it's a wound, and put compresses on, warm compresses 4 to 5 times a day. And so it was a Friday, and Friday the 13th to be exact. And so I left that Friday, and my anxiety was out the roof, and I went to Walgreens and I got saline wash, I got Neosporin, and I got some more gauze. I had some gauze with me already, but I got some more gauze. And I went back to the Airbnb, and I started doing my research. I did research all that night, and I did the warm compresses, and I did the, I washed it with saline, and I applied the Neosporin, and then I covered it with the gauze, and that's pretty much all I was able to do at that point. I had to go the whole entire weekend, not knowing what to expect. I was pretty much hysterical, and that whole entire weekend. And so pretty much that's all you can do. That's all I was able to do was take care of it like it was a wound. I had to the saline wash came in like a can. It squirted out, so I didn't want the pressure because it comes out like a pressure. I used it that Monday night only, and literally, like, the actual nipple part was, like, bleeding the next day. So I immediately stopped using that and went back to the Neosporin because I was like, oh, hell no. My nipple was not bleeding before that. So, but anyhow, when I went to the checkup on Monday, he was, like, doing this thing where you basically, he was, like, taking a pen and pushing on the nipple. And so if you ever, like, press on your skin and it is, like, it's, like, white and then it turns back red or it turns back to your natural color. So, like, if you're, like, reddish tone like me or tannish color, whatever color you are, and it's white and then it goes back to your natural color, that means that you're getting blood circulation. If it didn't turn back to the color, then you would not have blood circulation. So basically he said I had good cap refill. Basically my blood was resurfacing. So he said that's good. Basically my nipple was not going to be falling off. Thank God my nipple was not going to be falling off. However, I was not 100% in the clear because the tissue around it, like meaning like the circle part around it, because mind you, they cookie cutter out the nipple area and remove it, and then they reattach it and suture it around. I was not in the clear because the area around it was not completely solid. Like, we didn't know, I needed another week or so to tell if there was necrosis around that area. But the nipple itself, the nipple part that pokes out, I was in the clear for that. But the skin around it that gets sewed on, we needed another week to see if I was gonna have to, if I had necrosis there. So went home Monday with that and still was given the directions to continue. I was still doing the warm compresses I was still doing the wound care. And yeah, basically I needed another week still. I still was doing the wound care, whatever. And I was never told to stop using the Neosporin. And I continued to use the Neosporin 2 weeks later, even after I knew that I didn't have necrosis after like the 2 weeks had went by. So I'm going on 2 weeks. I knew I didn't have necrosis and I'm still using the Neosporin. I was never told to stop using the Neosporin. And I'm thinking that it's helping. I'm thinking it's helping because, like, if you get a cut, right, and you put Neosporin, it helps you heal and it actually helps with scarring. So I continued to use the Neosporin because I'm figuring that it's still not healed. You still got sutures or whatever, and I still have the gauze. So I'm putting on the bra, and I'm not gonna wear the bra without a gauze. So I don't want the gauze to stick to my nipples. So I had a little bit of Neosporin. I put Neosporin on there. But apparently I wasn't supposed to continue to use the Neosporin. And all of a sudden, a couple weeks later, after the surgery, my nipples started to itch. And for like 2 days and 3 days, like the third day, they were itching so bad. And I mean, like, so bad. And when I got out of the shower, I went to put the Neosporin on and they were burning. So I had to rub the Neosporin off. And it was like I had blood, like speckles of blood. And the nipples were like raw. They were like really, really red and raw. And I had to text Dr. Magic Mike. And like something's wrong. My nipples itch very bad to where they like burn itch. And I have like blood, like patches of like blood. So he's like, send pictures. So I sent pictures and he's like, you're using way too much Neosporin and you got a yeast infection. So I'm like, oh my God. So first the necrosis, I just got over that like a week ago. So it's like, yeah, so he was like, what's your, I need your name, the date of birth, and what's your pharmacy information. So I had to text him that, and then he was able to call in, thank God. I'm going to give you guys some, like, information, like, yeah. So anyways, so I was able to get a prescription to clear that up. I, just the one time, like, Diflucan, pill is what I had to take and then put some stop using the Neosporin and put some Vaseline so that they don't stick to the inside of your bra. So that's what I did. And, yeah, I just used the Vaseline and the itch went away. Like in a day. So yeah, I went through that, but that itch was freaking burning. Like that itch, I can't even explain to you how bad that freaking itch burn was. It was freaking crazy. So I went through that, and then yeah, so Silhouette plastic surgery and Dr. Magic Mike, the good and the bad. I don't know if I should do that or if I should do, I think I'm going to do about my surgery first. I think I'm going to do about like what exactly I got and all that stuff, okay? So, what exactly did I get? I got the gummy bear, cohesive gummy bear. I got the cohesive gummy bear implants, the gel. And what are those exactly? So, they are exactly like a gummy bear candy. So if you have a gummy bear candy and you rip it in half, that's exactly what it is. So if there's a puncture, a rip, or a tear, the gel is not going anywhere. Versus a saline is straight up liquid. You got an air bubble with saline liquid inside of it. So if that thing pops, bursts, or anything, that's straight up liquid inside there. If anybody punches you or it leaks or anything, like, that's a wrap. And then the silicone is gel, but it's more of a looser, gel. It's not thick gel. It's not like a thick gel that's going to just stay there and be hard. It's like a jelly that's like, it's more loose. It's more of a loose gel. Anyhow, so I got the gummy bear cohesive gel. And they give you a little card. They're the Naturel. I got a Naturel. I got a little card. And I asked for the smallest ones possible because I wanted to stay small. I wanted to stay a B34. I was told they had 180 cc's. But Dr. Magic Mike told me I was going to have to do 240 cc's. So that's what I was given. I was given 240 cc's. I don't know if that's all they had, but I wanted to go as small as possible. I feel that what I got is bigger than what I wanted because, you know, I wanted to stay, like, smaller than what I got. So, I don't know, but I got 240 cc's. And I already explained what I got. I got the incision or scarring. I got just the scar around that one, that side of the breast on the right side. I got just the The implant went through the nipple on that side, so I only have the scar around that side of the nipple on that side. I have the cut going down and then the incision going like the anchor. And I will insert a picture, of course, covering up most of the nipple so that I don't get demonetized. I have not started scar treatment yet, but I am about to, and I haven't picked out or tried anything yet. When I do, I will let you guys know and let you guys know how that the scarring treatment goes. I only need it for that side because I only have, I mean, I guess I could put it like around there, but it's not going to really show because it'll blend in with the circle or what have you. Okay. So, I had to get the incision with the line going down on that side and that because the left breast was bigger than this one. I did have some tissue removed out of the side, and I wanted them to be the same size. And they were asymmetrical. Yeah, they were asymmetrical, so they were a little uneven. So, yeah. Okay. Now they are even and perfect. Like, well, not, nothing's going to be exactly perfect, but they're basically like almost twins. Okay. So, what else? Pain level for me coming out, I was good. I didn't feel any pain for like the first few hours, but later on that night, I had to take two painkillers, and you're supposed to wait every 8 hours to take two more, and I could not, the pain was so bad for the first like week until the pain medication was ran out. Literally, it took me the whole entire dose of medication, pain medication that the doctor gave me, Dr. Magic Mike gave me. I could not wait until the 8 hours. Like, I was pushing 6 hours. Literally, I could not take it past beyond 6 hours. I could not wait another minute past 6 hours. That's how painful it was. And my limitations, it basically, you can't even get out of bed. So you don't realize, like, when you get out of bed, when you sit up, you're using like your muscles. So the implants are placed behind your muscles, your pectoral muscles. And when you're doing stuff, you're automatically using these pectoral muscles. So when you're sitting, when you sit up, you're using these muscles when you sit up. And we don't realize it. When we sit up, you're using these muscles. So when I got out of bed, I had to somehow slide out of bed. I had to roll out of bed. My limitations, I couldn't even get out of the bed. I had to somehow slide out of bed, roll out of bed. I had to like slide out of bed. Okay? You cannot sleep anywhere. You got to sleep on an incline. You want to have like literally you. I was lucky the Airbnb that I had four nice thick pillows. So I literally had the two on my side and then I brought the two on the other side and propped three up, but they were very thick. So I had the three there and then I propped the fourth one so that my legs could be at an incline. But you can only sleep, you gotta sleep for the first 8 days. You wanna sleep for the first 8 days, you wanna sleep on your back. You can't sleep any other way. So you wanna sleep on your back. It hurts, you can't like to push. You can't even push. You can't push to, you know how you gotta push and turn medication bottles? You can't push and turn and open up your medication bottles. You can't turn to open up your pineapple juice, your Gatorades. Those were a challenge. To even push, close a door, or to, if you're inside the door, to open up the door.
That is difficult. You can't do it. It hurts. You're pushing. You're using that pectoral muscle. It hurts. You can't do it. I would say for the first like 6 days. I would say for the first like 5-6 days. I did go on that Monday. So I had surgery on that Thursday. Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday. Thursday to Friday. Friday, Saturday, Saturday, Sunday. 4 days later, when I went for my post-op checkup that Monday, that first day after I was told that I had possible necrosis, I got Flexeril, which is a muscle relaxer. Highly suggest getting that because it relaxes your muscle. So you got the painkiller, but you definitely want to have some type of muscle relaxer. Okay, so let's get into what you need to do, because let me show you guys really, 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 really quick. This right here, let me zoom in. This is all you are given, okay? All right, let me read to you what it's got. It's got, this is post-operative guidelines for plastic surgery, Dr. Michael Rodriguez, patients. Okay, so it has bathing, apply ice, elevate, rest for the first 24 hours. You may shower 24 to 48 hours. Call if you experience excessive pain, bleeding, swelling, discoloration at the incision site, or fever over 101 degrees Fahrenheit. Remember, scars take a year to fully mature. Wear sunscreen SPF 30 over your scars after they heal. Garment/binders. Drains. Anesthesia, take your medications as directed. What should I wear? Dressings. That's it. That's it. That's what you're given. Okay? So, what they don't tell you about is it doesn't have anything about the strap. Yeah, so you want to start wearing your strap. It doesn't have anything about the strap. You want to wear your strap the next day, and for the first 2 weeks, you want to wear it 24 hours a day. You want to wear it going around, so you want to wear it. I threw mine out, but you want to wear it going on the top. So basically, you want to have it going on the top, come around here, and basically, you want to have it kind of at an angle going down here. So you want to kind of pull it down here and have it like coming up, and basically, you want to have it coming up here. So the purpose of it is to push down, to bring down the height of your boobs. You want the implants to drop, so you want the band to be up here, okay? So, they should have that on the paper. They should tell you. They should explain this to you, but they don't. Where the hell is my book? Okay, so there's that. The first 2 weeks, 24 hours. Now, if it goes into here, you could put, like, some type of cloth to, you could fold the cloth in half to put it, so that it doesn't, because it cut into me. So you could fold like a gauze, so that you could like fold a gauze like in on the inside and fold it, you know, fold it like in and out so that it doesn't cut into you. First 2 weeks you wear it 24 hours. The second 2 weeks you can wear it for 12 hours. I wore mine at nighttime and then took it off in the morning. Okay, so the massages. You start the massages 5 days after your surgery, and basically your massages, you want to start up at the top and you want to work your way to the side. So basically you want to try to push the outside of your boob in. So you're basically, you're starting at the top to push them down, and you're going to the side to push the boob inward. So you start up here, pushing it down, because you want to basically try to push it down, and you want to go to the side, pushing it in, because basically you want to get your boobs to kind of like go in. There's that. You want to do that like twice a day, preferably like when you're in the shower, and then maybe another time. And it basically, it kind of helps, because it kind of feels like sore. You basically, if you ever had a baby and your breasts fill up with milk and it hurts from the milk from your boobs being engorged, that's how it feels. So it kind of feels good to massage them. So there's that. What else? Yeah, so I had my surgery on the 12th of August. I really just healed up like a week ago. So it took me like 3 weeks. But to really be closed up, I would say during the last week. So it takes like 3 weeks. But everybody's different. Everybody heals different. So it took me like 3 weeks to heal. The stitches, they'll just automatically go away. What else? Do I like them? I don't know if I like them. I like them better now than what they were before, but I don't know if I'm liking the size. I feel like they're a little bit tighter in my shirts, and I'm not liking that, because I like small boobs, and I feel like they're a little bit big. I feel like they're bigger than what I wanted, and I don't know. I feel like I'm more of like a C now. I don't know. I'm wearing a B. I got a B cup bra now. I'm actually in a B34 bra. So I don't know. I don't really know. I'm still up in the air on if I like them, but I do like them better now than what I did before. But I just don't know if I like them. I just don't know. Okay, so Silhouette plastic surgery and Dr. Magic Mike. The good and the bad. Let's talk about it. Deep breath. Okay. I'm going to go with the good on Dr. Magic Mike. I like that I've been able to text him and he's able to respond right away. So I like that I was able to like show him what my problem was, and he was able to be like, you know what I mean? Like this and that, you got this, or this, you know what I mean? Instead of going through the surgery center and not getting response and this, that, because I've heard horror stories with other surgeons. I'm not going to mention any names, but I've literally gotten inboxes on horror stories about other surgeons. But at any rate, I love that about Dr. Mike, that literally he is a text away and can just phone call a prescription in if you have an issue. If you have any issues, I don't know if there was, God forbid, something really big that happens, that to where you have to have surgery again, and you're out of town. Like, let's suppose something was really big. Let's suppose I did have necrosis, God forbid, and, you know, I had to have tissue removed. I don't know how that would work, but I'm assuming that he would just do consent, or I'm not sure how that would work. I don't want to speak on that, but I just know from my experience that he's been a text away and checked up and was like, how are things going? Or if I had a concern, I would just text, you know, my concerns or what have you. And I like that I was able to do that. So got that out there. What I didn't like is that it's very, very, as I read to you guys, the very basic handout, it doesn't really tell you anything about, like, the strap. I literally had to, I think I was late wearing the compression strap. I had to bring it in and ask somebody else how to wear it, how to put it on, because I had no clue on how to put it on. When I asked Dr. Mike, how do I do the massages, and I was told to look it up on YouTube. So I actually had another girl that had surgery from another doctor in the Facebook group, the surgery Facebook group. She inboxed me some videos that I was able to watch on how to do the massages. So that's how I found out on how to do the massages. So there's that. And let's see. Another thing that I didn't like or appreciate is that I was told that my legs would look like deflated balloons, and I just felt like I was downed. And I literally was nervous. I was trying to explain to him that I was nervous, but I literally should have just went on my website. And I had other pictures. I had a lot of other pictures, but at the time I was just very, very nervous. And but I had other pictures that he could have saw how my legs were, but I had literally, my legs didn't look deflated, but I mean, my legs did not look deflated, or nor did I have any jiggle or flab or anything. I had literally no fat in my legs. Like, I was so skinny that I had no fat anywhere, and I was trying to explain that, but he wasn't understanding that. And so that was, like, frustrating me. And for him to tell me that I was going to have worse cellulite and that my legs were gonna sag and stuff like that, and I was literally trying to explain to him and show him, like, I only gained the weight so that I can have fat to pull. Like, I gained the weight to try, because my initial purpose and point of gaining the weight, I was supposed to get a BBL. Like, if you check the records, I was scheduled December 8th. I freaking did the a deposit April 10th, 2020, and was scheduled originally December 8th. Selena was like, you have no fat. You have to gain weight. Do you want to reschedule? Because you don't have any fat for a BBL. And it was telling me to drink a sure and this, that, and the other. So I had to reschedule and gain weight. I got down to 148 pounds. So I had to gain weight. So I gained the 20 pounds on purpose. So I was trying to, so I didn't like that. I didn't like that. And then especially I heard the girl next door, and then I found her on the Facebook group, and she had deformities from when she had the girl that he did, like, did the back lipo when I went in for a post-op. I heard him tell her the same exact thing, that she had deformities on her stomach. And so I saw her because I found out who she was, and I knew I was going to find out who she was. Because he told her the same thing that he told me about the stomach deformities. He was like, what are we going to do about your stomach? So exactly how he was able to fix her stomach, the deformities in her stomach, he could have did mine. He didn't refuse her, but he refused me. Lipo. So I don't like that. He declined me, lipo. He refused me, lipo. Because he said that I had deformities from a previous surgery, from a previous doctor that went aggressive, but he told another patient of his the same exact thing, that the doctor went aggressive. What are we going to do about your stomach? She had ripples. And he ended up doing, like, back lipo on her, because I guess the surgeon didn't end up doing back lipo when he did 360. He never went in and removed the fat off her back as he was supposed to. So I guess he added fat to her stomach to fix the deformities. So, I don't know. But anyways, that's that. But, yeah. So anyways, let's talk about silhouette. Oh, so I just want to add, I went ahead and scheduled the day before I left Miami. I went ahead and scheduled my BBL. So I have, I scheduled a BBL with another doctor anyways, and it's one that I really, really, really wanted anyway. But anyways, I'll get there. I'll talk about that later on because it was somebody that I found after I was already scheduled, Dr. Mike. So yeah, it was a doctor that I wanted to have do my BBL, that I wanted to do my BBL anyways, but I had already was scheduled with Dr. Magic Mike, so I was kind of disappointed. But I was like, oh, it's too late, I'm already scheduled. But so everything happens for a reason. But anyways, let's talk about silhouette. Silhouette has you, they will text you that your surgery time is such and such. You will be waiting for more than 2 hours before you get actual surgery. And that is not cool. That's not cool at all. And then also, as you guys can see, the waiting room before you have surgery is flooded. And I couldn't even sit down. Not cool at all. Not professional and not cool. If I'm paying $7,000, over $7,000, I should be able to have a seat in the waiting room before I have surgery. Not cool at all. That's very unorganized. When I had surgery at Ivana, I was scheduled, and as soon as I went in, I went immediately right in with the doctor and immediately went right under anesthesia and immediately went in for my surgery. Anywho, moving on. So let me talk about necrosis, okay? Because this is big, because I would hate for you guys to be told, like I was told, that my nipple could fall off or that you have necrosis and you have to have your breast removed or you have to have skin removed. It's very, very serious. So I want to give you guys some information on that, so that, and I'm going to tag the best way that I can, so that if anybody is experiencing necrosis, I'm hoping that you find my video and that you guys, so that you guys can, like, know a little bit more about it, because when I was looking, I was searching early in the morning until 3-4 o'clock in the morning everywhere. I was searching every keyword possible, and there's not much out there. And then you have all different type of necrosis. So I'm going to get into it. So necrosis is basically, it's basically death of the body tissue. So it's when your tissue dies. And it occurs when too little blood flows to the tissue. So when your blood doesn't circulate to the tissue and your tissue dies. And so what you can do, the only thing that you can do is try to care for the area just like you would a wound. So you basically would wash your hands and you would sterilize, you would wash the wound area with saline wash. It's the best way. I personally, every time I did it, I actually took a shower first. Now, I did it multiple times a day, so of course I didn't take a shower first before I did it, but what I was saying was that I would take a shower daily, and of course I would use nothing but Dial soap. You guys want to use Dial soap until you completely, until your wounds heal completely. You want to use nothing but antibacterial soap and nothing but Dial antibacterial soap. So I'm going to get, okay, so let me tell you. So I would take a shower daily, and then with the antibacterial Dial soap, and then immediately after that, I would use the saline wash and then dress it up. So you want to use the saline wash, and then I would take a gauze. I would never apply with my fingernails because we have bacteria, so no matter how good you scrub and wash your hands, we have bacteria that we cannot see up in underneath our nails, underneath our nail beds. Okay, so I would take a gauze and I would squeeze the Neosporin on there, and I would take the Neosporin that's on the gauze and apply it on the wound, and then get rid of that and then apply a gauze to it. So I would never apply the Neosporin with my bare hands. So my hands are never touching the wound area. So washing your hands before changing or caring for a wound, keeping the wound cleaned at all times. You want to change the dressings regularly. I wouldn't say too often, but I would change them like 3-4 times a day. So far as my breast, because I am talking about necrosis of the breast, I mean, if you guys are looking up and you're searching on YouTube necrosis, and you have, let's say, necrosis of the foot, necrosis of the ankle, because there are many different type of necrosis, then you do want to change the dressings at least 3-4 times. I would say 3-5 times a day. So me personally, I changed my dressing on my wound at my breast site 3-4 times a day. So you wanna take care of it like it's a wound, okay? You want to refrain from any smoking and any alcohol. Let me tell you, I wanted a drink so bad. My anxiety was out the roof. I was so stressed out that I wanted a drink so bad, but I Googled it and I said, if I just had surgery and I have a drink, if I have alcohol or if I have a drink, what would happen? And it said that alcohol would thin out my blood. And I immediately said, no, alcohol would thin out my blood. I need all the blood supply I can get at this point. And that brings me to another point. I started taking my gummy vitamins again, because I take probiotics. I take biotin. I take a daily woman's gummy vitamin. So I had all those with me. So I damn sure started taking my gummy vitamins, and my doctor said no, but I'm thinking, what harm is that going to do? What harm is taking a multi-gummy vitamin going to do but give me the nutrients that I need? So I took my damn gummy vitamin, and as I did research, it said that it's okay to take a multivitamin. So I'm thinking, that's why don't always trust your doctor. Don't always... You know what I mean? Don't always, if a doctor prescribes you something, it's okay to go ahead and look up what a medication is for. Look up the symptoms. It's up to you and what you put in your body. And what you put on your body, what you put in your body, it's up to you. You know what I mean? Don't solely only rely. You know what I mean? Hear a doctor out. You know, doctor does have their expertise, but don't only solely rely on them. Do your research. And I mean that with the bottom of my heart. You know, I've had doctors prescribe me medications, and I'll be in the office and look up a prescription and look up the symptoms and what it does. And when it says that side effects, this, and that, I've told the doctor I'm not taking that. So do your due diligence and look up. I'm just going to leave that with that. But I sure did. I started taking my woman's daily vitamin. I started downing pineapple juice. Pineapple juice has natural elements in it. I got Libby's. Well, I already had it, but I downed it. I downed it and I went to the Publix where I stayed at the Airbnb. There was a Publix right across the street. I went and got another Libby's, downed that, and then I had like an 8-pack of Gatorade. I was drinking so much that I was peeing out clear. That's how much I was drinking. I was drinking pineapple juice. I was drinking Gatorades. And then I had 5 packs of Arnica tea left over from when I had the BBL surgery in August of 2019. I only had 5. I wish I had more. And unfortunately, you can only order it on Amazon and other places. They don't sell it at Walmart or Walgreens or Publix. But I drank 5 tea bags of Arnica. That's really only for bruising, but it has natural healing elements nonetheless. So necrosis cannot be reversed. So if you already have necrosis, you can't get rid of it. So if you have necrosis, you cannot get rid of it. There's no medication that can get rid of necrosis. If you have necrosis, there's no way to get rid of it or reverse it. The only way that you, and if you do have necrosis, you have to remove it. Otherwise, it could spread bacteria, and it spreads pretty quickly. It has to be removed. And as a matter of fact, it spreads quickly. It spreads 1 inch per hour. So if you have necrosis, it's an immediate, it has to be removed pretty immediately because it spreads very fastly. And what they do is they like scrape it off. They remove it. If it goes, depends on how much it spreads. If it's just a little area, it could be scraped off. But if it gets to be a big area, then they have to remove that whole area. So it gets pretty serious. There's ointments that doctors tend to prescribe. Nitroglycerin is one of them. Signs of necrotic tissue is pain, warmth of the skin, redness, swelling. So swelling right around the site. And then if you have skin blisters, and then if you have a fever, like if you have fat necrosis, you tend to have a fever. So some of you women, if you guys get a BBL, women tend to get fat necrosis. So beware of fat necrosis, because they have such a thing as fat necrosis. And then with that, you get fevers of about 107 degrees Fahrenheit or so. So that's one of the, I know that's one of the signs of fat necrosis. Now, there's a woman's blog that I came across when I was doing my research. And she started a blog because there was no information on, there was literally no information on breast necrosis, and she actually, her story is really something. You know, she ended up, she started having nipple necrosis, just as I was told that I had possible nipple necrosis, and it ended up growing, and she ended up having to have both her breasts removed. And so she had no breasts, and she ended up having no breasts, and then she ended up having fat removed from her back to create new breasts. And so she ended up having breasts created from her back fat, and then with no nipples though, and then she had to decide if she was going to have some nipples made. And I'm going to put it in the description box, her vlog. It's called Boobcast, the book. And I just think that her story I just think that her story is something else. So I'm gonna add her blog in the description box. So I do hope that this helps some people. And you know, I didn't want it all be serious, you know what I mean? I like to joke around. I'm a quirky, giggly, goofy type of weirdo-ish, you know, emo. I'm emo too, you know what I mean? I'm emotional, I'm a bag of waters, but I'm goofy and I'm full of life and I'm spontaneous. Literally just like decided the same day last week I want to go to Tennessee and left just like that same day. I'm like spontaneous, butterfly, social butterfly. Like I love being goofy, but this was serious and you know, I just I put this, it took me a while because one thing kind of led to another, and I know some people were requesting my vlog with Dr. Magic Mike, but I ended up having a yeast infection on my nipples, and it was like, I just felt like, what else is gonna happen? Like, I wanted to make sure that everything was, like, done, and I'm gonna close this one out, and then I might do a 6-month post-op, like, with how things are going, and maybe how the scarring is, and if like what I've tried as far as creaming goes, and you know, if anybody wants to know about that, you know, because I think that I basically pretty much covered. If you guys have any questions, I try to cover as much as I could as far as my experience. That was a freaking heck of an experience because I completely was not expecting what happened to happen, and yeah, I was not prepared for any of that. Some other crazy stuff happened, but I wouldn't even... Oh, my Airbnb information I will put down below. There is a better spot that I would have went to because... I wouldn't even suggest the Airbnb. If you guys want to know where I stayed at, it was a lot of money, though. I wouldn't suggest it because it was, like, a lot of money. There's a way better place that... I would suggest, actually. So, there's a way better place that I would suggest, actually, that has, like, live entertainment. Yeah. So, anyways, I did stay at an Airbnb, but the place that I stayed at was so expensive. It was, like, $1,900. So, yeah, it had a nice pool, but the pool closed at 8 o'clock, and... It wasn't in the same building. I had to walk down like 3 buildings, whatever the case may be. But if you guys are interested in the Airbnb, but to me, it's not worth it because you're going there to get a surgery. You're not going there for vacation. Do you know what I mean? So I got to use it for 2 days before I got surgery. So it's pointless if you're going there for surgery. Do you know what I mean? So I really got it. I don't even want to go there, but I really got it for somebody else to enjoy that I brought down there. But I'm just going to say friends that you think are your friends are not your friends. And I'm just going to put it like that. But I don't even want to go there. But anyways. If you guys have any questions, I think I try to cover everything, but if I did miss anything or if you guys have any questions, then definitely ask and I will let you know if there's anything that you guys want to know later on. Then let me know, and yeah, I'm going to close this out, alright? I didn't want this to be too long. I just wanted to make sure that I covered everything. I was going to do a separate video on necrosis, but I was like, I'm just going to put it all together. I hope I helped somebody. If you liked my video and you learned something or I helped in some type of way, please give me a thumbs up, subscribe to my channel, and yeah, I will see you guys in the next video and next adventure. All right.